Assalamu alaikum, dear students. Welcome to the next lecture of public finance. In the last few lectures, we were evaluating various actions of the government in the economy in terms of their expenditure. And we were discussing, these would be the last few lectures on the expenditure side, where we have tried to evaluate various actions of the government, first in the sense of projects, and how projects would be affected, then what type of projects should the government take up. Then we were discussing what type of government actions in terms of subsidies and can affect the outcome in the economy, and how people would behave if subsidies are given. So we are moving in that direction. In the last lecture, actually, what we discussed was that we had certain hypothetical examples in certain cases, and we discussed how those cases of government subsidies distort the prices, and they would result into inefficient outcomes in the market, and what are the other solutions through which the same action can be done but in a much better manner. So based on that, we discussed housing subsidy, for example, and we based on in that housing subsidy example, we first highlighted that individuals might start to consume more of housing services than they would normally do in the absence of the subsidy. And then we looked at first in the lecture before that, we discussed how an individual would behave, and then in the last lecture we discussed what would be the effect of that behavior in the market. And the behavior was that they would increase the demand of housing services. So when they increase the demand of housing services, it might be an effect on the market as well, because in the last lecture we discussed those effects. And in this sense, in order to evaluate the outcome on the market, we discussed that there are two types of groups. One is the taxpayers, and the other one is people who are getting the subsidy. So what the taxpayers are doing, that they are paying, or they in fact they are financing that subsidy, and there is a cost to that. And then we discussed then what would be the benefit to that. If that is the cost, what would be the benefit, and how much benefit they would acquire out of it. So when the subsidy is given, the benefit, we divided those people into two categories. First category was those people who were already availing that facility privately, but when the subsidy is, when they are listed as people who are eligible for that subsidy, they would get into that, and they would utilize that benefit by the government. And the second number of individuals would be those who would not be availing housing subsidy at the market rates, but they would be willing to get that facility at below market rates, of course, when it is subsidized by the government. So we discussed in that when we add these benefits and we have the cost in front of us, and we saw that costs were greater than the benefit, and they are greater in terms of the fact that there is an excess burden to it, and that excess burden or the deadweight loss represents an inefficiency in the market mechanism. Then we also discussed another type of a subsidy which might bring the price of the product essentially to zero. Now, what happened in the previous case as well and in this case, that people would start to consume the product wherever marginal benefit, even marginal cost is greater than marginal benefit. So in the next example we discussed, that was specifically, I guess, of medical care, in which there was a medical subsidy and a Medicare program, Medicaid program by USA, in which actually it is the largest program in which they subsidize medical services for large number of poor individuals. And the subsidy is up to the level where there is no cost to them, so they pay no price for that. So the price is essentially zero for the use of that service. So in that case, people would actually utilize that service in terms of to the point where marginal benefit is equal to zero. The downward sloping marginal benefit curve is zero. Up to that point, they would utilize that facility. And we proxied that with the quantity that the individuals would consume. We proxied that with number of visits to physicians and hospitals and various medical service offices, and we again discussed that again that resulted into an inefficiency in the market and an excess burden, of course, and a better ideology in the last example as well. In this one, we came out that it would be better if they were given like cash grants, and they can adjust their consumption based on those cash grants. And the reason for excess hospital visits when the price is zero was determined to be that the individuals, since they have nothing to pay for, so they would even visit the hospital for even for normal ailments and some things that they might even treat at home if they have to pay for it. But then, since the medical is free, they visit the hospital. And we took this example on further onwards, and we discussed that that has an effect on overall market as well, in a sense that considering an upward sloping supply curve and considering a increasing marginal social cost curve, which would be the same in this case. So that would mean that with more demand, the hospitals and medical services need to supply more. And in that sense, the shift in demand curve outwards results into an intersection at a higher equilibrium point, and that would result into increased prices of medical services. We would keep on discussing that today as well in some other aspect also, but in the last lecture we discussed that resulted into a double burden on the taxpayers. One burden is that they have to finance the subsidies, they have to pay taxes for that, and the activity for which they are financing and paying taxes, because of increased demand of that, the prices go up, and now they have to bear a higher price for getting the medical services for themselves because they are not subsidized. And so on one end they are paying taxes, on the other end they are paying higher prices. And that is like for example an effect from both sides and from two different angles, and they might reduce the quantity demanded of medical services based on the scenario that I have just explained. So double burden is some sort of unjustified. Then we discussed a scenario of public housing. This was not a case of subsidy. In this example, the government actually would construct apartments of the same size, and then they would ask those individuals who want to avail that facility, who are eligible of course, and they would take up that facility. And in this scenario we discussed that it might be also be possible that individual might be who might be living in a 4-bedroom apartment, considering the subsidy, he would be forced to shift in a 3-bedroom apartment because there is no lack of choice for there is a lack of choice for him. So in this scenario it would be again much more better if for example he is given you can say a cash grant rather than that house, and that cash grant up to a certain level equivalent to the amount of subsidy that is being given. Like in this case, the public housing case, we discussed that those houses are given out at $90 to these individuals, we assume that, and their market price is $300 per month. And in this case, the subsidy amount is actually $210, and if the government could give those $210 as a cash grant to these individuals, that would result into a much better choices by these individuals, resulting into that they would be at a higher utility curve than before. So now coming again discussing a few more examples, now in a little bit different context. Now we have been analyzing that these subsidies might distort the market outcomes, but there might be also cases. We also discussed at certain places that if the amount of subsidy or the cash grant is kept to its minimum level so that it does not create some income effect, in fact, then that income effect and substitution effect won't be the cause of an efficiency in the market, and people won't be consuming more than what they would normally do. So this is exactly an example. We need to discuss that scenario over here. Now keep in mind that the examples we make in order to understand are specifically made for an objective. In each of the last cases we explained those objectives, that why we are discussing this, and we explained certain scenarios in which it was possible to achieve that objective with a different methodology like cash grants. So now we would be discussing another example in which case that subsidy might not create an efficiency for certain people. And why is that? So that for that we need to go into the example. The example is about like subsidizing food. Now food stamps are the subsidy that allows the recipient a particular allotment of vouchers to buy food, but the recipient may supplement the subsidy with their cash also. Now it is illegal to sell the food stamps, but though it may be in the recipient's interest for them to do so. So it is basically a voucher sort of thing, and in this case that voucher is only can only be utilized for food legally, but it is a possibility that it can be used for cash also or traded in with each other in term for cash. So let us discuss two different cases in this. Now we were discussing previously that in terms of subsidies it was much better if government could give a cash grant, but this is not actually a cash grant, but it is some sort of cash grant, and it has another aspect that we would discuss later because its amount is very low. So what effect this kind of a subsidy would have on the individuals, as well as of course through that we can consider what effect that would have on the market. Now in this case, for example, in case of this is a subsidy in kind, because it is basically a food stamp, so people would be only be able to use that for food items. Now if you look at the graph being displayed on the screen, first consider that the budget line of the individual is IA. There is no subsidy over here. So in fact I should explain the axis first. On the x-axis there are the number of units of food consumed per month, and on y-axis there are expenditure only on all the other goods. Now there is an indifference curve. We have explained indifference curves in detail many times. Now this indifference curve represents any indifference curve on this plane would represent various combinations of food quantity of food with all the other goods, and which would give an individual equal level of satisfaction. So initially, in the absence of any food stamps, individual is at utility level U1. So at this U1 utility level, his equilibrium point is E1, and why E1 is the equilibrium point, because it is tangent to the budget line that he has. Now IA is the budget line. Budget line actually represents a certain level of income. For example, his total income can be 0A and or 0I, and that level of income would allow him to purchase a maximum level of various baskets. He cannot exceed that, he cannot go beyond that, because he cannot afford it. So this budget line represents the various combinations of food and all the other goods that this individual can afford. So the point of intersection or the tangency point of your desired levels and what you can afford would be the optimal point. So E1 represents the point of equilibrium where the individual is at initially, and at this point he is consuming QF1 units of food and M1 units of all the other items, all the other goods that he is consuming. Now what would happen is, now let's assume that there is a government subsidy. This government subsidy would shift the budget line outwards, but because it can only be used for food, then there is a representation over here that budget line cannot go up to the level of BA slash, because B to point C is unattainable point, because amount of that the food stamps cannot be utilized for purchasing anything other than food, so they can only be used for purchase of food. So over here what happened is that his initial budget line was IA, and his new budget line is ICA prime. Now, this is the new budget line after the availability of food stamps. Now, so his total consumption, now immediately he would move on from the utility level U1 to utility level U2, which would represent a point of equilibrium of E2 over here. And his quantity of food that he would be consuming would be QF2, and all the other goods are represented by M2 over here. Now, keep in mind that he cannot go above the point C on this budget line, represented by the dotted line B to C, and that is unattainable area. The reason is that the food stamps cannot be used to purchase any other items. So the total consumption of food is basically the food stamp that she receives from the government as a subsidy, and as well as some spending by herself. And that the reason is that is the reason why her budget line has shifted outwards, as well as she can consume more units of food and more units of all the other goods. Now grants freeze some of her own income, which was previously being used for the use of food items, and now she is, since she is consuming now food plus food through her own income plus the food stamp, so that would increase the total quantity of food, but that would also give her you can say certain extra money that she can spend on either on food or on other goods. So that is why the budget line has shifted outwards. Now the case over here is that if the food stamp the amount being subsidized is represented by F in this graph, which is between the point B and I, and she cannot go to that point, of course, and go on that part of the budget line. So F is the amount of subsidy on the food or the food stamp. So the point is that if that much amount was given to her as a cash grant, she would be better off. But since her point of equilibrium and indifference curves are in such a manner that she is at point E1, it would be fine for her if she moved to the point E2. If she had been at point on the budget line at point B and C, then in that case she would be in problem, and she would be much better off in case of a cash grant rather than a food stamp. But in this case, this particular scenario has been designed to show that this food stamp has not affected the individual that much, and a cash grant would have enabled her to attain that point, but she is not requiring, she does not want to attain that point. So this individual is fine in the presence of in-kind food stamps. But then let us consider another example in which that point actually affects an individual. So what would happen over here is, again there is another scenario in which the initial budget line is IA of an individual, and that individual is and the point of tangency is at the U1, where the where she is at the time of without any food stamps. She is consuming for example QF2 units of food and M1 units of all the other goods. The scenario is still same. On the x-axis there is food per month, and on the y-axis there is consumption of all the other goods. It's not mentioned over here, but it is the same graph, just being portrayed in a different scenario, where we want to say that cash grant would be much better for this individual, because she was the previous individual was fine, but this individual would be affected by the food stamp. And how she would be affected? Because currently she is at equilibrium point E1 and utility level of U1. Now when there is you can say subsidy provided, now she moves to the point C. Now because she preferred to move to point E2, but because the constraint that she cannot attain that point between B and C, so she would be at point C at the utility level U2, and at this utility level she is consuming QF1 units of units of food, and I represents to I the maximum units of other goods that she can obtain. But if on this case she cannot move beyond point C on U2, so she is not better off than before, and this is not exactly the point of tangency of the indifference curve with the budget line. So she is not better off in this scenario, and she could be better off if she could move to for example point E2 and at the utility level U3, which is much higher, and at this point she would consume for example Q1 star units of food and L units of all the other items. Now this shows that in this scenario, if she was given a cash grant, she would be much better off, because in previous case the individual was not affected by the food stamp or the cash grant, but this individual would be affected by the food stamp or the cash grant choice, because if she is given food stamp, she would be at utility level U3, but if she is given a cash grant, she would be at utility level U3. So you see, these examples have been designed specifically in a sense to explain this concept that cash grants would be more successful to and individuals would be more better off when you are trying to subsidize them in any sense. The main implication is that given the average amount and each recipient would spend on food is already greater than the subsidy, because subsidy is not that big. So if the subsidy amount is not that big, that would mean that individual would already be maybe spending more than that amount. So if you subsidize a part of it, maybe if I spend like $300 on food every day, maybe $100 every month. So if I spend $100 every month and you subsidize $30 out of that, so that would only benefit me in a sense that I would use the $30 that I used to spend on food and to purchase additional items or maybe some more units of food. Plus maybe I would spend like $80 on food plus the food stamp of 30, that would make it 110. I would increase the food consumption, and the remaining $20 I would take it to consumption of all the other goods. So if the cash grant is not that much, then it would be not affecting the market efficiency or market outcomes very much. So in this case the subsidy can be treated as substitute of cash grant, because it's very low, and only a situation where the subsidized amount is low enough. Now remember this, that I have repeated this many times. If the amount of subsidy is low enough, so only that would be the case where there would be where we discussed like work incentives and all that. If the amount is low enough, then that would keep individuals at their feet, and they would keep on trying, and market outcomes would not be affected. But if the amount of subsidy is a lot, then that would mean the cases like of public housing or housing subsidy or Medicare cases, in which people would not be they would be consuming a lot more than what they would be doing normally. So the reason of showing this example specifically was so that we could see what would be different aspects of subsidies by the government. Now several nations use price reducing subsidies to make food more affordable. Now programs that reduce the price of food benefit higher income people as well. There are in certain countries there would be general cases in which they subsidize the food for everybody as a whole. They won't be specifically targeting for example low income people. Now then there are countries which only low income individuals food consumption is subsidized by the government, and then again there would be there are countries where they would if they want to subsidize rather than subsidizing, they would actually distribute the food to their recipients. Now then we have been discussing the choices of layer, and we have been discussing that what is the effect of various government programs on an individual choice of whether they want to work or not and how much they want to work. Now, a grant ensures minimum level of income independent of work. So, larger the grant size, greater is the disincentive to work, which we have discussed like just a few minutes back, a few seconds back, in fact, not even minutes. Now, if the size of the grant is very large, then that would be creating now. Coming out of housing subsidy or coming out of food subsidy or coming out of medical subsidy. We are specifically now discussing sort of an unemployment benefit if, or fund in which people are given if they are unemployed in order to maintain a minimum level of standard of living to keep them maybe above the poverty line. That would be a scenario in which people would be supported in terms of assistance program so that they can maintain a minimum standard of living. Now, grant ensures a minimum level of income independent of work. These types of grant would, individual starts working a little bit, that won't reduce the grant until a minimum level is reached. Now, larger the grant size, greater is the disincentive to work. The main thing is that there is an income effect that makes work unfavorable. We would discuss that in coming slides. Now, transfer could cause people to work more or less depending on whether layer is a normal good. The main theme is that whenever there is an increase in income, there is a tendency in people to increase the consumption of normal goods. So if we treat layer time as a normal good, so in that scenario, it would exactly be true that with increase in incomes, people would increase their layer time also. So what would happen to incentive to work when individuals are given assistance in times of unemployment or assistance in times of low income? Now, it is very important to conduct an economic analysis of all this scenario, and it can be conducted using indifference curves again, that we have been using them again, and in this indifference curve we would be having an individual's the utility level on each single indifference curve. The utility level would be same, it is always same, and it shows the various combinations of work time and layer time on which an individual would be, for example, would give him the same level of utility. Now, layer basically? Layer is engaging in any activity other than a wage earning activity. If you are doing anything other than an effort to earn a wage, that would be treated as layer over here. And then the maximum amount of layer an individual can have is 24 hours. Any less than that would be meant that he is striving to earn more income. So what would be the budget line in this case? Now, we would be coming to the graph, don't worry about it. It's not that I'm just going to explain these concepts in terms of these verbal slides. There would be a graphical analysis, but we are building up to that slowly. It is always useful to build up to a scenario slowly and consistently so that nobody loses track. There might be cases that you might already know this stuff in terms of indifference curve analysis, but there would be other people who do not know even basics of that. That is the reason that we need to take everybody along. So that is why I explained the concept of indifference curve in the start, and now we are using them, but since we lack practice in them, so it is necessary that we discuss them slowly and steadily. So the impact of we are basically discussing an impact of government assistance program on work incentives. So we are saying that we are going to evaluate this in terms of economic analysis by using an indifference curve analysis. Now, on an indifference curve, it is called an indifference curve because individuals are indifferent about various combinations of market baskets on them. So in this case, market basket would be the layer time and the work time. So we need to evaluate that what would be the effect of government subsidy on the choices of layer and work by an individual. We would take this analysis again later on when we would be discussing the retirement funds, but this is like sort of from the perspective of unemployment fund. Now, then we also, in the indifference curve analysis, we also need a budget line. And budget line actually represents all the combinations of the two goods that an individual can afford. So the two goods in this case are leisure time and work time. So basically, person's opportunity for giving up leisure for work would be represented by this budget line. Now, non-wage income is treated as zero over here if the person is, for example, in the leisure times, there would be no income, and if he is working for a wage, then there would be earnings to him. So what would be his total income be? That would be wage multiplied by how much time out of 24 hours he works over there. In other words, 24 minus L represents the leisure time over here, and I represents the income per day. So in out of 24 hours, for example, if an individual works for 5 hours, that would mean that he is resting for 19 hours. So 24 minus 19 as a leisure time would represent 5 hours, and 5 multiplied by the wage rate at which he is employed would represent an individual's total income. So now, coming to the graph as such, we need to see the effect of income. Now, let us assume that on first of all, on the x-axis, there is leisure hours per day, and on the y-axis, there is income per day. So in terms of leisure hours per day, there is the downward sloping straight lines represents the budget lines. Now first ignore the top two lines and consider the only line represented by A to 24. This budget line represents, downward sloping budget line represents what the different choices of individual in terms of leisure and working hours that he have in a day and he can afford. And the indifference curve over here represents all various combinations of work hour and leisure hour that would give an equal level of satisfaction to the individual, which is represented by U1 over here. So at the point of on the right side on the x-axis, there is 24 showing that the maximum time an individual can spend for leisure hour is 24 hours in a day, because you cannot do that. There are only 24 hours in a day, so maximum time is 24 hours. And while we move left on the x-axis, there is there can be that represents that for example on the origin there are 0 leisure hours and 24 working hours, and in between it represents the various choices on the x-axis that how much leisure he would be taking, and rest of the time we will be treating it as working hours. There is a point of intersection which is represented by E1. We are only considering the first budget line and the first indifference curve. The first indifference curve is represented by U1 over here, and the first budget line is represented by A224 over here. Now, without in case of no transfer payments, the individual would be spending L1 hours of leisure over here. We are assuming that at a point E1, and the rest of the time he would be trying to find work or working at some minimum level. Now, if we discussed in I guess last lecture or lecture before that, that why it is very important, why certain people would consider these types of initiatives by the government, because market outcomes sometimes result into people earning less than they should, and or less than the minimum sustainable level. So if that is less than minimum sustainable level, they are not able to sustain their everyday requirements of nutrition and food and clothing, and in that case where this is where the government comes in. Now the government would subsidize, and in terms of those for those poor individuals who cannot earn enough. Now, in specifically in this case, we are considering that now the government is giving a transfer payment to those individuals who are not earning enough in terms of a minimum standard of living. However, minimum standard of living is defined, like we discussed that in USA, it is defined to three times the nutritional the value of a nutritionally adequate diet. So why three times? Because one amount would be spent on the nutritionally adequate diet, and the rest of the two would be spent on all the other goods. So and in, for example, maybe on World Bank and on international forums, it is poverty is measured by like people living on less than $2 per day or $1 per day. So that represents the minimum thresholds we consider below which that people are living a substandard life, and they are like living a life of a poverty. So in this case, there would be a transfer payment, because we are considering that the individual is at the minimum threshold. So he would be given a transfer payment by the government. So what would happen once he is given a transfer payment? Now we are seeing, we are treating it as an income effect of transfer. When an individual would receive a transfer payment by the government, his budget line would shift outwards, upwards. That is represented by C and D over here. That would be the first transfer payment. If that much amount is transferred to the individual, then his new budget line, his new line representing the various combinations he can afford, would be C and D. And at this point, he would find a point of intersection of U2, or tangency point of U2 on U2, the higher utility level, which would be point E2. And with this point, it is shown over here that individual would increase his leisure time. That increase in leisure time is represented by the income effect, because now he has more income, and now he considers that he can spend more time in leisure, and he can devote more time to rest, for example, or leisuring activities. Now, if the transfer payment is increased further up to point G, the budget line would shift further outwards. Now, that is again representing another budget line, FG, which is there is a dotted line over here that represents that individual cannot enjoy more than 24 hours of a leisure in day, because there are only 24 hours. So the maximum amount is 24 hours. That's why the budget line is moving up in this direction. So at this point, the new budget line FG, the transfer payment of worth up to this much, would make an individual's point of tangency at point E3. And in this case, a bigger amount of transfer payment would represent even a full layer. So in this graph, I hope you understand what we are trying to prove over here is, we are trying to say that as which we have discussed earlier, that as the amount of cash grants increases, the result would be that there would be inefficient choices by the individuals, which we have discussed in all the subsidies. So in this case also, if as the amount of transfer payment increases beyond a certain level, the individuals would be choosing to spend more leisure time, and their work incentive would drop and would reduce actually. So the increase in transfer payments induces individuals to increase leisure hours and reduce work per day. This is the basic implication that we needed to show in the previous graph over here. This is a similar implication which was also shown in case of public housing or Medicare facilities, Medicaid, or also housing subsidy in terms of when the government was subsidizing rent. All those examples showed that because the transfer grants were of larger size, what happened was that individuals started to choose more of the quantity consumed, more of the quantity consumed, because then they would normally do in the absence of such cash grants and in the absence of such subsidies. So in this case, the example is somewhat similar on the similar grounds, that greater the transfer payment would reduce the work incentive of the individual, and they would prefer to consume more leisure hours than more work hours. Now another basically work for disincentive, this is another way to analyze that. Now there are certain types of transfer payments by the government, specifically in developed countries mostly. When they reduce the amount of the transfer payment, when an individual starts to work more and more and earn more and more. Now those transfer payments, for example, would be at maximum when individuals has zero working hours, just like in the last graph. But in this case, we are looking at it a similar example, but from a different angle. The first work disincentive we discussed in the previous example was that greater the amount of the transfer payment, lesser would be the desire of an individual to get out of that transfer payment cycle. Now another analysis in this, in a similar example, would be that if a government provides a transfer payments based on the scenario that more income you earn, your transfer payment would reduce. Now that would also, the way in which the benefits are reduced to an individual when he earns more income would also be a disincentive for an individual to work more hours. Now subsidy of BD shifts the, now this is about the graph that we are going to discuss, the subsidy amount shifts the budget line up from the point he will be paid point C in the figure. Now let's go to the figure. Now what happen is that on the x-axis there are layer hours per day and on y-axis there is income per day. There is a budget line represented by AB over here, that is the choices of various combinations he can afford. And first ignore the utility curves. What is happening over here is that when there is a transfer payment by the government, now that shifts the budget line from that point CD. Why it exactly shifts the budget line in this way, because at point C the individual would not be given any incentive, because as I discussed that there are certain types of transfers, mostly these are the types of transfer that more an individual starts to work or earn income, the lesser would be the transfer by the government. So at point C and above there would be no transfer payments by the government. So since the transfer payments are only applicable from point C onwards, that would represent that would make the budget line shift and go to from point C to D, and that represents the maximum amount of the daily transfer over there. Now subsidy shifts basically the budget line up to CD and decreases slope with more layer. Why this decrease, the shifting of the budget line upwards and decrease in its slope would mean that it would reduce the person's wage, real wage, as he works less than 24 minus L hours. L star represents over here is. Now so what would happen is initially we would consider that individual is at utility level U1 and his equilibrium point is E1 and he is choosing L1 as the layer hours, and L star is basically the point where if he works that much and this is the amount that he layer he has, then based on a certain level of income he would not be eligible for any more cash grants. So on rightwards from the point C he is eligible for cash grants, and the maximum cash grant is represented by when he is in layer for 24 hours. That would mean he is not working at all. So the more he works, he would move on the line C and D towards left, and that would represent lesser layer hours, and that would again represent more working and more income and also less transfers by the government. That is why the budget line is its slope is decreasing continuously along CD. Then also let us consider there are no cash grants in the start, and the individual is at equilibrium point E1 and on utility level U1. E1 is the point of tangency of this utility indifference curve and the budget line. But then the government starts the subsidy or starts the transfer in terms of for those individuals who are minimum the bare level, which is represented as C over here, bare level of income earnings per day, and they would subsidize them. And the lesser they work or more layer they have to, the government has to subsidize them more or transfer more amount. So at this point individual would immediately move to the utility level U2, and he would be at equilibrium point E2, the point of tangency, and his layer hours would be L2. Now you see that his layer hours based on this cash transfer, his layer hours has increased a lot, and from L1 to L2, and representing a higher level of utility just based on the government transfer. Now this in this graph, in the last graph actually we only had the income effect. When an individual's income increases, he would treat layer as a normal good as he would treat all the other good, and he would consume more of all the normal goods, and that would automatically mean that he would consume more leisure time also. Now this graph specifically represents the income as well as the substitution effect. Income effect in the that same old sense which we had previously. Now substitution effect in a sense that more work actually, more work incentives, more work increases the work income, the income that he earns. There are two types of income this individual is having. One is the transfer income and the other one is the work income. You know, work income is when he works and he earns a wage over there. Transfer income is by the government when they consider that the wage he's earning is not up to the bare minimum standard. So what is happening over here is that with more work, work increases, his work income increases, but his transfer payments reduces. So that again creates an incentive for the individual to substitute the work hours for the leisure hours so that his transfer payments are not reduced. So in this graph it is shown as the income effect as well as the substitution effect of transfer payments and income effect and substitution effect towards disincentives of an individual for not working anymore. So basically what is the why individuals behave like this? Because having such side type of transfer payment reduces the opportunity cost of leisure time. There is an opportunity cost to leisure time for all of us. Like if you as a student, you are if we treat not the work but specifically the amount of study time that you have, the more leisure you have more time you spend on leisure, there is an opportunity cost for them because you are foregoing time for studies. So if we consider this for working an individual and leisure time for him, then if he is working, he is foregoing certain amount of leisure time, and when he is in leisure, he is foregoing some work income. So more cost to that, higher the income he has, higher the wage rate he has, that would mean that the opportunity cost of his leisure time is very high. But since these transfer payments are directly to the individual, whether he works or not, up to the point C, then actually these transfer payments are reducing the opportunity cost of leisure time. So he is being paid for the leisure time. So that again creates a disincentive towards work. Now in these scenarios, again as we discussed, that low levels of subsidies are desirable. Why low level of subsidies? Because they are enough, just like we discussed in terms of the food subsidies, that they are enough to make them survive, but they are not enough so that an individual has an incentive to go out of labor force just for that transfer payment by the government. And there have been studies like certain states in USA don't even pay enough transfer payment to individual to bring them above the poverty line. They pay them just enough to survive so that they keep on looking for jobs. And it have been statistically discussed that lesser the amount of such transfer payments increases the incentives of an individual to find work. Now this is actually the evidence I was discussing about. A 10% increase in welfare payments, this is the evidence on as a whole, but there have been certain cases in various states in USA where minimum amount of transfer payments resulted into individuals for trying to find jobs to get a sustainable level of income. Now a 10% increase in welfare payments to individuals decreases work effort by 2%. So with a 10% increase in welfare payment, the amount of transfer payment that are being done by the government, it decreases an individual's work effort by only 2%. So even if welfare benefits are reduced substantially, if we take it other way around, or rate at which they are phased out with earnings is reduced, the increase in work would be insufficient to reduce poverty as such. Now this is at a broader context on the level of poverty, because that is again associated to the opportunities being provided in the economy, that is associated to even the level of skills and training that is imparted in the individuals when they are being trained. it is there are so many other factors that are incorporated in removing the level of poverty. It is not just these payments and the work incentive that would affect that, but it specifically shows over here is that with a 10% increase in welfare payments, the individuals decreases his work effort by only 2%. So taking this on, then another scenario of welfare payments by the government, a very interesting one that needs to be explored and discussed, is a negative income tax. Negative income tax is a system where there is no status test, but there is an income guarantee and a take back rate. We would come to income guarantee and take back rate, of course. Status test, actually there are certain, this is basically a proposal that floated in USA some time ago, negative income tax, and it has its intricacies because of which it cannot be implemented, of course. And you would also be amazed at the first glance that this can be a very ideal scenario for any country also, but then there are very strong implications of it. We would discuss that, don't worry. The point is that the status test through which individuals are subject to when they are being made eligible or not, when it is being decided that whether an individual is eligible or not, are demeaning to certain individuals. So there should be a system all around away from it. We can bypass this whole system and implement a negative tax, for example. Negative tax is an interesting concept that there is a minimum income guarantee for everyone. Now, what would happen is that people below, let's assume that we have a minimum income guarantee at 30,000 rupees. Now, maybe for a household of, or 50,000 rupees for a household of four individuals. And of course, that would depend on the size of the household, of course. But if we say that a household for four individuals may have 50,000 of basic income, so anybody earning below that income would be subsidized by the government. Anybody earning above that income would be paying taxes to the government. And anybody exactly at that 50,000 level, the minimum floor that they have decided, would neither be paying taxes nor he would be subsidized by the government. You see, it seems like an ideal scenario in which anybody who's sort of working and has reasonable standard of living, he would be paying taxes, and all those taxes would be utilized by the government to pay to an individual who's not working, or pay to an individual who would be working at like maybe 30,000, he would be paid by that household of four would be given a 20,000 grant by the government. So what do you see? Like, I hope we have had this debate before many times, and we have discussed this in detail. Can you like pick out any sort of scenario or any single statement which can you can relate to this that we have already discussed? Of course you can, just think hard. It's we discussed that under equitable distribution of income, equity versus efficiency trade-off. This is all about equity, the negative income tax. Negative income tax is all about equity. It's a normative economic perspective, and it is simply saying that all the individuals of household four should have around a minimum of 50,000 of income. And no doubt there would be people who would be earning more, but most of the individuals, in fact all the individuals of household of four, would be getting 50,000. Either they earn it or they get it from the government. No doubt that would again be reducing the work incentives, and all that debate is put aside for this moment when we are discussing the negative tax. There are implications of that, but we would like might sheer reject it based on certain intricacies in itself without having to go for efficiency and work incentives and all those aspects. So what is a negative income tax? Is a system where there is no status test, put that on side, but there is an income guarantee and a take back rate. Now, a minimum income guarantee for everyone. Everyone is going getting a simple, a certain amount of subsidy, or he is paying tax. People below the floor will receive subsidies, while people above the floor will pay taxes. Now, floor would vary with the household size. Of course, you cannot say that a household of 10 individuals would also need 50,000, while a household of 4 individuals would also need 50,000. We need to define that based on the number of households. Then there is a take back rate, and there is an income, a minimum guarantee. Now T is basically the transfer over here. This is the formula for the negative income tax. T is basically the transfer. IG represents the income guarantee, the minimum income guarantee. We discussed, as I said, that maybe for Pakistan we can say that 50,000 is the minimum payment, or 30, let's call it 30,000. We're not that a rich country. So maybe 30,000 as an income guarantee for all the individuals who considering a household of 4 individuals, 30,000 is the minimum income guarantee that they would have. Now, what would happen is there is a take back rate and there is an earned income. Earned income, we would do consider it numerically. You would be able to understand it much clearly when we do it numerically. Now, there is an earned income. For example, if the earned income is zero, let's say, the individual would be getting the income guaranteed. We said 30,000, he would get a complete 30,000, because zero multiplied by the take back rate is zero. So he would get a transfer of 30,000. But if his income is, for example, 10,000, that would depend on now what is the take back rate. Take back rate is the amount that out of this, how much the earned income is to be, for example, the take back rate is 50%, or 0.5 is being multiplied over here. So if he is earning 10,000, then 0.5 of that would be 5,000, and 5,000 minus 30,000 would be 25,000. So 10,000 he is earning himself, and for example, 25,000 is being given by the government to him. So there would be a minimum income guarantee by the government, and we would discuss this numerically, and it would be more easy to understand in that aspect. So zero would be the rate where IEG is the transfer break even income would be at point of break even income. That would be zero, because as I said, that now we assume that 30,000 is the minimum floor. So at 30,000, he would neither be paying taxes nor he would be given a subsidy by the government. So in this case, IG minus TN over IB would be exactly the same. So 30,000 would be minimum income guarantee, minus if the individual is earning 60,000. So 60 into 0.5 would be 30. 30 minus 30 would be zero. So an individual earning 60,000 won't be paid at all. We would discuss that in a very in a better example, which defines it in a different way, in a more clearly. So over here there is a table which is a hypothetical table, and on the first column there is an earned income by the individual, and the minimum transfer by the government is treated as 5,000. IG is 5,000 basically, and the take back rate is treated as 50% of the earned income. And then on the last column there is disposable income of the individual. So if we start from the first row, the individual's earned income is zero. So that would mean zero multiplied by the take back rate would be zero. So the total transfer would be 5,000 by the government, and that would be the 5,000 of the disposable income. Now let's assume that the income now he starts to earn, and now he is earning $1,000 or rupees. So the formula of the transfer would calculate that as 5,000, the minimum income guarantee, minus the take back rate into 1,000 that he has earned. That would make it 500, and so the total transfer would be 4,500. So his disposable income would be 4,500 of the transfer, plus the 1,000 that he is earning himself, and the disposable income would be 5,500. Now, let us do like one more to understand this clearly. Now, let us take the third case, in which is basically the fourth row. An individual is earning 2,000 earned income. He is earning $2,000 maybe. The minimum income guarantee is 5,000. Take back rate is 50%. 50% of 2,000 would be 1,000. You subtract that from the minimum income guarantee, which is 5,000. So now you have 4,000. So 4,000 is the amount of transfer by the government. Now this plus the income that he has earned himself would be 6,000 of disposable income that he has. So if you go to the last column, the disposable income is continuously increasing as individual keeps on working, and there it would be the level where an individual would not be transferred by the government. He would have reached the minimum floor, and that is the last row represented by 10,000 over here. His earned income at this moment is 10,000. The minimum transfer guarantee by the government is 5,000. Using that formula, the take back rate of 50% would bring up 5,000 again, and so his transfer by the government would be zero, and his disposable income would be 10,000, how much he has earned himself. And at this spot, that would be the minimum floor, and the government has defined the minimum floor to be 10,000. So he would not be given any sort of transfer payments as soon as he reaches this level. So what are the implications? Why I said that at the first glance it looks like an ideal scenario. Now, an individual earning more than 10,000 would be paying taxes. So all the individuals earning more than 10,000 would be paying taxes. So all those taxes can be accumulated to such type of an activity by the government across the board, where there is a minimum income guarantee for all the citizens of the country. And what a like an ideal scenario that would be. But then there are difficulties in this, which are very complicated, and we can prove that by examples simply. No, a very expensive program, because minimum income guarantee is needed to be set to a reasonable level, because if you set it too low, then it would be of no use. So if you consider equity, then they should be set at a minimum level, at certain level. So assuming in first example, when I'm trying to prove like for a family of four, assuming that that minimum income guarantee by the government is 20,000 per year for a family of four, and the take back rate is 50%. Now all families of four with income less than 40,000 will be eligible. That would automatically mean, and especially in when there are no status tests, but that is not our debate. All families of four with income less than 40,000 will be eligible. Now you see, there is like a huge chunk of families who would be earning that much or less than that, and all of those need to be subsidized by the government in one way or the other. There would be a minimum transfer rate. Now if for example we try to be smart and we decide that okay, the transfer rate, the take back rate 50% is too high, and we should reduce that take back rate. Why? Because that would create incentive for the individuals to work, because at this take back rate, everybody would be happy to stay at home and earn $40,000 per year and live a minimum standard of living. But let us push people to work, and let us reduce the take back rate from 50% to 20%. So that would automatically mean that the level, the break even point, would go from 40,000 to 100,000. So now all the people below 100,000 would be given transfers by the all those people below 100,000 and a family of four would be given transfers by the government, and above that people would be paying taxes. And now that would mean that government would need to increase the tax rates on rest of the population to fund this whole activity, and there would be prices of all the government goods and services would also need to be increased to finance such activity of such a magnitude. So you see, as I said, that negative income tax seemed very equitable and very a greater opportunity to eradicate poverty. If it were, then every country would be doing that. But then there are issues in it, and it is basically a concept where you would have to increase taxes a lot, and that would not be treated as fair, because taxing so much and giving such a huge level of subsidy, and then governments, where would governments own other expenses would come from, military defense and air pollution, all the activities that are conducted by the government, national defense, all those activities conducted by the government just across the board would be need to be financed also. So the tax revenue that you collect would only go towards such type of transfer. It is an ideal hypothetical scenario, but it seems to be very, you can say, too optimistic for practicality. Now, this would be if we consider a flat tax rate, like maybe 20% flat. We would discuss taxes later on in coming lectures, but a flat tax rate would be a tax rate of, for example, 20,000 on the income that you earn for after that break even point to everybody. So you would have to tax various incomes just to finance these kind of transfers to the government. And again, you see that in this graph there is annual income of the individuals on x-axis, and there is annual disposable income ID on the y-axis, and there are taxes that are required to finance those individuals, and the tax rates would have to be increased to meet the requirement of all those subsidies. Then this negative income tax plan was interesting to explore, but it was necessary to explore it, because that is a concept prevailing in that is a proposal in the United States once given over there and under debate also, and we should know about this stuff as well. It might come up in Pakistan sometime as well. So then there are wage rate subsidies by the government. Wage rate subsidies are the cases where government adds to wages of certain working poor who government might think that they are not earning enough, maybe because of the market outcomes that we discussed earlier. So those would be wage rate subsidies, and those would also be allocated in a sense that for example, there is a table over here showing that if wage paid is from represented over here from $2 to $5, then subsidy per hour would also be as per the wage they are earning. They are trying to maintain a minimum level of wage that each individual would earn. So in this slide that you are viewing over here, on the first column there is wage paid, the wage being earned by an individual currently, and then how much the government would subsidize that wage. If you work for 5 hours at wage paid by $2, then you would be maybe if you are working for 10 hours and your wage is $2, you would be earning $20, and the government would subsidize that by the amount of $1.50 per hour. Now you see, the basic aim over here is, in this sort of a subsidy, is to it is an incentive for an individual to work, because the subsidy is also coming hourly. More you work, more subsidy would be granted. So an individual would be earning his own income as well as subsidy by the government based on the number of working hours and not on the leisure time, which we discussed earlier, and that has certain effects. Now this is another way to bypass that system where individual have disincentive to work, but in this case there is an incentive to work for the individual, because more he work, more amount of wage he would be earning, plus a subsidy on every or that he contributes towards work. So his total wage received at the end in the first row would be $2 plus $1.50 plus he would be equal to $3.50. In the absence of that subsidy, if he works for 10 hours, he would be earning $20. But if he is working for 10 hours with that subsidy, that would be $35 in total, and the subsidy would be amounting to $15 for those 10 hours. So that is a way, and that subsidy would reduce with the number of hours reduced by the individuals. So automatically an individual has an incentive to work with this type of a subsidy. And when we move down, you see that the amount of subsidy being provided is reducing with the increase in the wage rate per hour, but that does not affect the individual as such. His total earnings are increasing, number one. And number two, if the subsidy is going down, that does not push an individual to reduce the number of working hours, because if he reduces the number of working hours, it would automatically reduce the wage that he is being paid without the subsidy as such. So an individual earning $5 per hour would be given a subsidy of zero, and his total income, total wage received would be $5 per hour. Now that individual does not has an incentive to reduce his number of working hours, to reduce number of working hours. And specifically, this is not based on the number of working hours, this is based on the amount of wage that is being offered per hour. So this individual won't have any incentive to work for a lesser wage rate, maybe 4.50 over here, because then he would not be better off, and he would be working at the same number of hours. And if he need to reach that threshold of $5 of total wage received for 1 hour, he would have to increase the number of working hours. So there is no benefit for this individual to show any sort of disincentive to for work. Now I would considering we are almost out of time, I would summarize this lecture once, and then we would move on to I would explain what we would be going through in the next lecture. And we very soon we are going to finish with the expenditure part of the government, and we are coming towards the government finance, the sources of the revenue and taxation, and the effects of those actions by the government on the economy as a whole. Now we have been discussing the impact of various government incentives on actions on the economy, and those expenses in a sense that they are subsidizing either wage rates, or subsidizing food or housing, or subsidizing medical treatment. We are basically seeing the effects of those subsidies by the government, that type of expense by the government, on the market efficiency, as well as on the behavior of those individuals who are being subsidized, as well as because it creates a deadweight loss and it creates a burden on the taxpayer as such. So first we discuss the food stamps, in which case the government allows there is certain additional limit of food items being purchased. These food stamps cannot be used for any other item. In the first case we discussed that it would not affect an individual, because number one, as I highlighted, that the amount of cash transfer in terms of the food stamp is very low, and since an individual is already consuming more of that amount on regular basis, most probably, so that amount won't affect him. It would only provide him with extra cash to substitute towards use of other goods, because he or she had lesser cash for those items once he was spending that money on food. So in the first graph we showed that individual budget line would shift outwards, but there would be a constraint on the individual that since the food stamp can only be used for food, so it cannot be used for any other item, and so he cannot access the area BC on budget line on after it has shifted, because the food subsidy is specifically being provided is specifically focused for you can say food items only. So his equilibrium level would on U1 would move to U2, where his new equilibrium point would be E2, and he would be much better off. Now if this individual wanted to attain the point on the budget line, which is BC, then in that case he or she would not be happy with the subsidy, which is shown in this graph as such, because that individual was in a place on U1, his level of consumption towards food, because he or she never consumed food that much, so his or her the consumption basket, the total basket, contained more of other items rather than the food items. So if such a subsidy is given to this individual, then she is already on closer to Y axis, when the food subsidy is given, she is forced to move to point C, the maximum level that can be used for that subsidy, but she is not better off over there. Instead, if she is given a cash grant, then she can use those cash grants to for the purchase of other items which are more favored by this individual. What is the implication of this is, given that an average recipient would spend more per person than the grant, so the subsidy can be treated as substitute for the cash grant, because that frees some income of the individual for spending on the other goods. And so this is only the situation where the subsidized amount is low enough. And then we discuss certain international cases, how various governments might provide food subsidies to their citizens. And then we were discussing the effect of certain assistance programs by the government, like transfers in cases of unemployment on their work and leisure behavior, and how they would, it might change their behavior. And that is in the sense of income effect discussed in in the graph that we discussed over here, which showed that and maximum number of hours for the layer for an individual were 24, and that individual would choose, might choose in this scenario to L1 at equilibrium point E1 of layer. And this layer, if transfer payment is made, the budget line would shift upwards, because you cannot enjoy more than 24 hours in a day. So his new equilibrium point would be E2, and he would be increasing his layer hours. Why is that? Because his income has increased, and this is the income effect that is resulting into increase in the layer hours. And we considered that with an increase in income, an individual increases the consumption of his normal good, and since layer is also a normal good, then he would automatically increase the consumption of that also. And with the transfer of even greater amount, the individual would end up working not at all and going out of the labor force. Now then we discussed another scenario to analyze this, that what if the incentives are being changed with the amount of the transfer and with the amount that individual is earning. So if more earning he has, then the transfers by the government are reduced. So in this case, we assume that point C or L star would be the optimal point, where if an individual would work, he would not require any transfer by the government. We assume that. So an individual at point E1 and utility level U1, whenever there is a transfer by the government, he would move to E2 and utility level U2, and he would increase his layer hours. And this is basically the substitution effect, because previously it was the only income effect. Now substitution effect comes in when you find out that more wage you earn, you have to sacrifice layer, and your transfer payment is reduced. So now you substitute your work for layer, because you are being paid for that time also. So again, the low level of subsidies are desirable. Then we discussed the negative income tax. Negative income tax were an interesting scenario, in which there would be a very minimum level of income that an individual would earn. And there would be an income guarantee that, okay, if you earn zero, you would be given this much. But more you earn, there would be a take back rate on that, and certain amount of the total income guarantee would be reduced based on that, based on this formula. And we saw an example of it over here, which clearly explained that and if an individual is earning zero and the minimum income guarantee by the government is 5,000, then his disposable income would be 5,000. But more he earn, for example, now he earns $1,000, and the minimum income guarantee is 5,000. So at a rate, take back rate of 50%, that would make his transfer to 4,500. The amount of transfer by the government has reduced, and that when added to his disposable income would result into 5,500 of total disposable income. So and there would be a break even point, which is like earning of 10,000, which would say that, which would represent that there would be no transfer payment by the government in this case. This would seem like a very good scenario, but as we saw that with huge masses of population earning a certain level of income, because if you in this case, if you say that we are going to apply a negative tax scheme, you would be at least setting a minimum income guarantee at a reasonable rate. So at that reasonable rate, there would be a huge part of population who would become eligible for those transfers by the government. And then the issue is about that the in order to finance those, government would have to increase the tax rates and increase the prices of other government goods and services. So this was the graph which explained that scenario, that tax rates would have to be increased to finance such a huge level of negative income tax plan, in which people below a certain level would be subsidized and people above that certain level would be taxed. Now then there was a concept of wage subsidies or government additions to wage designed to increase the pay of the poor, and this was basically discussed in a table format. Now the main good thing about these wage subsidies is that they are given on the per hour basis, and if it would be like if you work for one more hour, I would give you this much for that extra or other than that what you earn, and this rate would be reduced with the increase in the amount that an individual is earning, and at certain level it would be reduced to zero. So it actually keeps an individual's incentive to work while also giving him support for support from the government also. In the coming lectures we would be discussing first specifically the pension scenario, in which how pension changes an individual's incentive to work, specifically again taking this example in and his incentive to work as well as his saving behavior, whether individuals save while they are being given pensions or they reduce their savings. That would be an interesting scenario to discuss. We would do that in the next lecture. Hope to see you again. Take care.